This is Dr. Tiffany Lamberton of TMD Collective, and this is another episode of Jaw Talk Podcast. Happy holidays. This is going to be our last podcast of 2023, and I'm so excited for our guest today. I've been wanting to have her on for a long time. Not only is she an amazing TMJ dentist, but she's also a social media sensation known as the TMJ Doc, Dr. Priya Mistry. With a unique approach to patient care and a wealth of knowledge on TMJ disorders, Dr. Mistry is here to share her journey, insights, and expert advice. Whether you're a patient, a dental practitioner, myofunctional therapist, or just curious about TMJ, this episode is packed with valuable information. But before we start, just a quick reminder, if you find value in our show, please remember our show is entirely listener supported. So in this season of giving, even a small donation of a monthly subscription of $3 a month goes a long way to help us provide amazing content and continue the podcast. So check out the link in the show notes. And so now let's welcome Dr. Priya Mistry. Quick legal disclaimer, all information in this podcast is the opinion of the speakers and not meant to be a substitute for a diagnosis and consultation of a qualified healthcare provider. Hey everyone, it's Dr. Tiffany of TMD Collective, and this is Jaw Talk. And you guys, I am so excited about my guest today. I have been wanting her on the show for 6 months. The one and only, you know her on social media as the TMJ Doc, the one and only Dr. Priya Mistry. Thank you so much for being on the show with me today.
Thank you for having me. I'm equally excited to be here. For those of you listening, watching, whatever, Dr. Lamberton and I just talked for like 30 minutes about others. We were like so excited to meet each other. So I am equally excited.
Thank you. Well, I started watching some of your YouTube videos back in 2020, and I was so impressed by your awesome explanations of how to release your masseter muscle and all of the instruction that you provide people. I think it's really valuable. So if you guys don't follow her on YouTube, you need to subscribe to her YouTube channel. You need to follow her on Instagram. Her content is amazing. It's informative. And I just love that you always talk about treating your patients with compassionate care, because that's kind of a core value of mine as well. And I think in the TMD space, that kind of gets pushed out the door sometimes with like a high volume, busy dental practice. So, but you're a general dentist, just like I am, that has gone into TMD only. Tell us a little bit about your journey and how you got into that.
Yeah, so I was lucky enough to meet my mentor, Dr. Arthur Parker, sort of on a whim. I walked into his wife's jewelry store, and her and I are both chatty, luckily, and she told me what her husband was doing, that he's been doing TMJ work for the past 30 years in the Portland area. And so I got in touch with him. I began shadowing and observing, and from like day one, hour one, I was hooked, because he was doing things I had never seen other dentists do. Like, he was checking people's posture and leg length, and if one shoulder was higher than the other, or if their head was tilted or rotated. And I was like, what are you doing? Why does that matter? And how does this connect to TMJ? And so I was just lost. I was coming from one tooth at a time, my little world. I had been practicing general dentistry for 11 years at that point. And so I was coming from there to really looking at the whole body and the whole picture. It was really eye-opening for me. And so from day one, I was hooked, and that turned into a mentorship. I bought the practice, so that was 2018. I bought the practice in 2021. And that same year, I moved it from Portland, Oregon, just 10 miles north to Vancouver, Washington. So yeah, here I am, and I'm loving what I do. And that was sort of how I got here. I got really lucky. We'll put it that way.
Well, I love it. And I love that you're just like 2 hours south of me. So we're going to have to do more collaborating, because I definitely think there needs to be more women in dentistry talking about TMD, talking about airway, talking about myofunctional therapy, and just getting that bigger lens of how the body works and how oral health is so intrinsically connected to our overall health and well-being.
Certainly. Yeah. I look forward to it. I'm so glad you're not too far away.
So walk us through a little bit. If I was like a patient and I was in your area and I saw you on Instagram and I was like, I want to see her. What's kind of like the process that you ask like a prospective client or patient to go through?
Yeah. So for my local patients, right away, we set up a comprehensive exam. For the patients that travel to see me, we do a Zoom consult first, just to evaluate whether I can help or not, because I don't want people to spend their money to fly all the way here. And then I'm like, I don't think this is a TMJ issue. That would be awful for the patient. So if you're local, we set up the exam, and the exam is pretty comprehensive. We get a thorough history. We do muscle palpation, joint palpation, jaw range of motion, postural exam, craniosacral evaluation. We check the bite. There's a lot of things that we do that go into that exam. And by the end of it, I usually have a pretty clear idea of what's going on and usually how the patient got there too. And so then we sit and talk about it. I explain the condition and then I explain the treatment, and we sort of go from there. And we have a pretty good success rate here, pretty high, probably above 90%. And when I say success, people are like, what does that even mean? So that means like people graduating from treatment, finishing treatment with a good, healthy range of motion, no pain on at rest, chewing, or with opening or yawning, and really decreased pain or gone in terms of like jaw pain, ear pain, headaches, neck pain, etc. So many people go from being debilitated in so much pain to being very functional by the time they're done, and that's immensely gratifying. I love it.
That's amazing. So when you're looking at different joint conditions, you know, we talk a little bit about whether that articular disc is kind of covering the top of the condyle and whether they're having popping where the disc is maybe reducing back on top of it, or maybe that disc is kind of stuck out in front of the condyle and they're locked closed. Mm-hmm. What would you say if you had someone who came to you that just really could only open like 5 millimeters, that their joint is locked closed?
Yeah. So for those patients, if they can barely open, then we cannot make the TMJ orthotics that I typically make, because we need to get impressions or scans of the teeth. So they need to be able to open enough at least for that. So for those patients, we have what we call an emergency protocol, which we need to rename it because that sounds scary, and it's not scary. But what we do for those patients is we try to gently increase their jaw range of motion. And the way I do that is we have appointments set up, and it can take 2 or 3 appointments, or sometimes it can happen on the first one. But for about 45 minutes to an hour, we actually hook up the muscles to a little TENS unit, a muscle stimulator. So it gets the muscles in the head, neck, and jaw nice and relaxed. It brings fresh blood flow, flushes out toxins that have built up in those muscles. And then after that 10 session, I come in and I do a very specific sort of therapy protocol. So I loosen up the muscles in the neck. I start there. I work my way forward, the temporalis muscle. I work on the masseter a lot. Then I don some gloves. We go inside the mouth. And once I've gotten everything as loosened up as I can, then I do some very specific jaw stretching and manipulation to help to increase the range of motion. Sometimes we can even get people unlocked, but not always at that first one. Once we have them open enough, that's usually around 25, 26 millimeters. That's when we can get some trays in the mouth or scan the teeth or whatever is needed to get the molds of the teeth. Mm-hmm. Then I use a very specific protocol with neuromuscular dentistry where we actually measure the relaxed position of the muscles. Once we have that measurement, then we can make some orthotics. And once we get those in the mouths, then we can really start moving forward faster. And so that's sort of how I would approach a patient that can barely open, is we gotta increase that range of motion.
Yes, yeah. Well, and it's a scary feeling for the patient as well, too. Mm-hmm. I've definitely had some of those patients where mm-hmm. either it was after a restorative procedure, or maybe they had an endo procedure with a root canal and ended up being in that position. And it definitely is scary and can be very, very painful for sure. Yeah.
Yes, certainly. Yeah.
That's wonderful. And then tell me a little bit more about, you know, you're involved with, you said, neuromuscular dentistry and the ICCMO. Tell me a little bit about how you got into that organization.
Yeah, so my mentor was always a part of ICCMO, or ICMO as they call it. And that's, for those of you listening that don't know what that is, it's the International College of Craniomandibular Orthopedics. So it's quite a mouthful. But basically, it's a lot of dentists that come together and really understand how an orthotic worn over the teeth can help the alignment of the jaw, and that can have really strong descending effects on the body, and it can help the alignment of the whole body if done correctly by someone who knows what they're doing. And so ICMO and neuromuscular orthotics often go hand in hand. Neuromuscular dentistry is the type of dentistry that really recognizes how the muscles and the nerves play a big role in what can be going on with TMJ conditions. And so I'm very much involved in that. My mentor was always involved in that. And it is a big part of how we practice here. So I'm a big proponent of it. Now, to kind of clarify too, I use the neuromuscular technology, but I also use my knowledge of the jaw condition to tweak what that shows me and customize it for each individual. And that does need to happen. If you use the neuromuscular technology alone for these very, very, very severe TMJ cases, I don't think that that works. You have to have an understanding of what's happening in the joint and kind of what that patient can tolerate in terms of an orthotic too. So take that with a grain of salt.
Well, and I love that you bring in like myofascial release. Mm-hmm. I think you had posted recently, you know, you were at one of the ECMO meetings and someone was doing some myofascial release on you and you were like, ah! Like, yeah. It's not like a massage. It no. is intense.
Yeah. He was taking volunteers and my hand shot up so much faster than everybody else's because I've had this awful, like, knot in my left trapezius for as long as I can remember. And when he released the SCM on me, he was going with so much force that, and when he got to one point, what was interesting is I felt pain shoot from there to the knot. Mm-hmm. And that's when I yelped out and I was like, oh my gosh, it shot through there. And he said, yep. And I thought, wow, it's coming from there. That's a trigger point, right? And so that was really eye-opening for me. And, you know, I do this stuff all the time, but experiencing that is right. not something I experience all the time. So that was really neat. And I've actually reached out to him since to see if he offers any courses because I'm always trying to learn more and more and more.
Yeah, I love that. That's amazing.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's funny because, you know, in dental school, you know, obviously we went through head and neck anatomy and, you know, but then once you start working on the teeth, it's almost like people forget about the musculoskeletal system and how those two joint muscles and the upper cervical spine, how much that, you know, and your posture, how much that right. influences how your teeth fit together. So mm-hmm. I love that you have kind of that bigger lens of looking at things. I think it's extremely unique. And I think we need to educate more dentists, as what we were saying before we started recording, is more dentists need to be aware of these hands-on techniques and how useful they are. Because I think a lot of times what I hear from general dentists is like, oh, you have a TMJ problem? Where's my referral pad? I want to just get you out of my chair as quickly as possible.
Yeah.
Which is not helpful for the patient because
it's not comforting.
They're not getting their diagnosis. Absolutely.
Right. And I was definitely one of those people till I met my mentor. Like, if somebody had a TMJ issue, I was like, all right, go to this person. Good luck. Bye. Because I just didn't know what to
right. do. Right. Yeah. Well, and what's crazy is when you look at, I mean, I just went to a lecture by Dr. Mark Drangschul, who's oral medicine at UW, and he was just talking about the epidemiology and the prevalence. You know, it's like 10 million people worldwide have this. We know it's more females than men. You know, he was like, even in just like Seattle, Tacoma, Everett, it's like 600,000 people have some type of oral facial pain. Sure, it may be odontogenic or tooth may be number one, but TMD is like number two. So mm-hmm. how do we get all these people into our chair, right?
I know, right? That's what I'm doing.
You're there.
What I'm doing with my social media is just let people know that there's help out there. And like so many of my patients, and we talked about this before, have been gaslit by the medical community or, you know, decrease your stress, you're fine, or go get a massage, you'll be okay. And it's like, no, this pain is real. And decreasing their stress is not going to help it magically go away. It's coming from somewhere and that needs to be treated. So it's tough seeing those patients that have been gaslit multiple times because they're almost afraid to tell you their story, like you're not going to believe them. Mm-hmm. You know, so I always try to be very empathetic and very compassionate when meeting with my patients, always.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, that's what makes you a fantastic dentist.
I try. And you too. I mean, it sounds like we're very aligned on that. And so that's great. And
yeah, definitely. I mean, yeah. My kids make fun of me, but I'm like, you know, my superpower is my empathy. Okay. Mm-hmm. I may not be like funny. I may be cringy mm-hmm. on social media, but I am definitely like an empath. And, you know, I think, like you said, when you have experienced some of those physical symptoms, you know, like I've been in multiple car accidents, I have had jaw issues, I've had bite changes, and, you know, I've had people tell me like, oh, it's fine, you know, but what people don't understand is that as the joints are breaking down, your bite is changing. And mm-hmm. so, you know, a lot of times the dentist will try to fix the bite, but it's beyond the bite. And you have to really look at that bigger picture of what's going on. It, you know, otherwise, you know, I don't know about you, but you've probably had patients who've come in that have had 30 equilibrations where they've mm-hmm. had their teeth adjusted over and over again, mm-hmm. trying to chase down the pain and the problems, and mm-hmm. The bigger picture wasn't, you know, really evaluated. So.
Right, wasn't addressed.
Hi there, I'm Dr. Tiffany Lamberton. I'm dropping in with a quick friendly note before we jump back into our podcast. Let's chat for a moment about mentorship. If you're a dental professional wrestling with TMD cases that you're really struggling to get it, I understand. The complexity of diagnosing, crafting those detailed treatment plans, and ensuring your patients are comfortable, it's a lot, isn't it? Here's the good news. You don't have to manage it alone. I'm here to offer a helping hand with my personalized one-on-one coaching and consulting services. Drawing from my rich experience in temporomandibular joint disorders, as well as my physical therapy background, I'm all about guiding you through these challenges with ease and confidence. Think of me as your personal mentor, here to bolster your TMJ management skills. Together in our sessions, we'll dive into the practical know-how I've gathered over the years. From strategies to helpful tips, I aim to streamline your practice and enhance your effectiveness. The best part, our sessions are super flexible and designed to fit right into your busy schedule. We'll focus on comprehensive learning, and that's not just about TMD, but also touches on improving patient communication and growing your practice. So no more feeling overwhelmed by TMJ patients and TMJ pain. With a bit of teamwork, you can boost your experience and confidence. Ready to take that first step? It's easy. Just swing by tmdcollective.com/VIP to book your first session with me. Let's team up to take your TMD management skills to new heights and really elevate your practice. Your path to becoming a TMD expert starts now. And now let's get back to the show. Yeah, yeah. That's amazing. Well, talk to me a little bit about disc recapture, because I feel like that's kind of like a hot topic right now in the dental community.
What I found is that, you know, many people will say the disc, once it's dislocated or displaced, it cannot be recaptured. And I totally disagree with that. It can be recaptured. I've done it hundreds of times now. But it does take the correct treatment protocol I'm not saying mine is the only correct one, but I know mine works. So what I do is I do make these orthotics, and for the patients whose discs are displaced without reduction, the jaw is locked closed. It does help guide their jaw to a more forward position, but there's also other components or dimensions to that. There's a right and left dimension you have to take into consideration, a vertical dimension. So in three different dimensions, it's sort of working to help that disc get recaptured. But I have found that orthotics alone for me will not recapture the disc. Always, as most of the time they won't. And I did see one patient where I gave her her orthotic and I saw her the next week and she was unlocked. And I was blown away, because that almost never happens. It's usually a slower process. And with that slower process, what's involved is we give the orthotic and then we see the patient back in a week. Then I do about my half an hour protocol of the loosening up the muscles from the outside, we go inside, we manipulate the jaw. And at the end of those treatments, I always check and adjust the orthotic, because it can't change, but every patient can. So we slightly adjust it to keep up with their change. And what I usually see is they start to open up a little bit more, their pain goes down a bit, and they start to click and pop again. And that's a good sign, because the disc is now getting back in alignment, or starting to. It's coming kind of in and out of alignment. And then as we go through treatment more and more, that clicking and popping goes away, they open up more, their pain goes away, and that's what I see. But I do have to see them again. So many people want to come here, get the orthotics, and never see me again. And I just, that's not going to work in my experience. So I do see that we can recapture the disc successfully, but it takes time and it takes work. And most people who come in with that condition are in treatment anywhere from 7 to 9 months. It's not an overnight process. It's just not.
Well, and I think, you know, kind of the gold standard for sort of seeing where the articular disc is really MR imaging. And, you know, the disc can have like those little collateral ligaments on both the medial and the lateral, and those can get stretched or torn. So you could have maybe just one side, but you still had have coverage on the medial part, or you could have that disc completely dislocate. And sometimes it'll go off laterally where you'll see like a little teardrop shape, or sometimes it'll go kind of towards the midline. So like anterior medially. What I've seen, especially in older patients, is that if that disc goes all the way dislocated into the lateral pterygoid muscle, so that sometimes that disc goes from, I call it like a grape to a raisin. So it gets kind of desiccated. And, you know, so I'm always careful with like, especially sleep appliances, because I think I was telling you, I found this out the hard way, is that sometimes if you're pulling a patient forward with a mandibular advancement device to help the airway, you have to know the condition of the joint, because sometimes you can make the joint worse by a sleep appliance, you know. And when I started getting into sleep, you know, they were always like, oh, an open casket, you don't want that, you know, open bite is better than an open casket, you know, you can just sort of sacrifice the TM joints. But you know, that's why I love that we have at our disposal as a general dentist, and not everyone does, but a cone beam CT to be able to see the skeletal changes and what's going on there with the airway, as well as the MRI, which is going to show the disc and the soft tissue. And it's also going to give us a lot of information of whether there's joint effusion in the joint space or condylar edemas in the marrow. So sometimes if that disc is just partially herniating, a lot of times you'll see what we call like a bright stir signal, where the marrow space of the condyle will just be lighting up like little white dots. Mm-hmm. Where there's so much marrow edema happening there. And that's where I feel like that's a high risk patient, because that's where you could have that collapse of the actual bone, where you know, have the condyle, instead of being that nice convex surface, it can start to really deteriorate. So some people have kind of already gone through that, and other people may be in the process of that. So definitely, you know, that complete history, I think, is I'm right there with you. That comprehensive exam is so important to be able to, you've got to diagnose your patient first before you treat them, right? I think as dentists, we want to just jump into treatment like, oh, I know how to do clear retainers to change your bite, or oh, I know how to do, you know, crowns or fillings. And we've got to kind of slow down and get the diagnosis with our patients. So I love that you're doing that with your patients. And like I said, I see a lot of similarities in how we approach, you know, that bigger lens of skeletal system. And I'm passionate about educating other dentists, because I feel like I didn't get any of that in dental school.
Yeah. And I went to a great dental school. I just didn't.
I know. You went to UOP, right?
Yeah. Where'd you go?
I went to Loma Linda.
Yeah. Great. Yeah. So, but I just think in dental schools in general, they don't teach that much about it. Like they teach like basic diagnosis of like, you know, the disc, what's happening there, but the headaches, ear pain, jaw pain, stuffy ears, vertigo, all those things that can come along with it. I don't remember any of that being taught in depth in dental school at all. And so it's, and you know, I'm still learning. I feel like with some patients, it's such a process to get them unlocked, and with other ones, it's not. And some people respond quickly, some people don't. And you just look at the whole picture and you take it all into consideration. You start to see some patterns, but it's just a continual learning process for me.
Absolutely. Well, and patients can have, you know, pain layers from different sources. You know, they could have muscle pain, they could have joint pain from inside the joint, they could have referred pain from the from the neck or the cervical spine. So
and you know, it's interesting, because in dental school we did the dissections of cadavers, like abdomen and up, right? But I remember we were just like pushing the fascia aside, like get out of the way so we can see the real stuff. And the fascia is so important. Like you know, the fascia is so important. It can be tight and constricted, and there can be pain coming from that. And so having an appreciation for that is like a whole new thing for me too, you know? So it's like I said, I'm always learning.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And what I think is exciting is, you know, being able to bring together our knowledge about airway and sleep, as well as myofunctional therapy, and then also the joints and kind of the physical therapy piece of it. So you really need all of those components to be like working together to really, you know, get our patients the best outcomes.
Yeah, totally.
But, you know, I think we've seen the differences in, you know, how orthodontia is being done. You know, I have young kiddos, and I think you have young kiddos too. And it's just, it's really interesting to see the shift, you know, that's happened, you know, where they used to take out a lot of teeth and just kind of constrict everything together. And now we're realizing, you know, maybe that's not the best way of managing that as we're starting to see these systemic issues of anterior open bites, cross bites, you know, occlusal asymmetries. You've got to look at the skeleton, right? Not just the teeth. So I do think, you know, it's an exciting area where there's a lot of enthusiasm. And like I said, I think the general dentist should be the one really leading the education charge, because we're taking the time to really go through all this additional training beyond dental school to kind of get to where we're at. So
no, totally. I think I mentioned before, I'm going to come out with some courses, hopefully next year, because I just think that people need to be able to diagnose what's happening. I mean, patients deserve to have their practitioners know, like, how to diagnose this and what's going on, at least a basic diagnosis. It doesn't have to be super detailed, but something, so they're not told that it's in their heads, or to de-stress and they'll be fine. Like, there needs to be more. People deserve more. So I'm hoping to come out with those courses. There's just not enough hours in the day.
I love it. I know. I feel like there's days where you're like juggling the kids and the puppy and like this and then the practice. And I know, like, if you could see my home office right now, it's such a mess.
It looks perfect right now.
No, I was like, okay, well, your episode's going to air around Christmas, so I've got to like at least get some like Christmas things. No, I love it. That's why I like it when people are like, well, this is real life versus Instagram.
I know. I do like that too. I do appreciate that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, tell us like some of the things that you're excited about that are coming up for you. You said that you've got some courses that you're working on. Are you looking at a specific platform like Kajabi or Teachable?
I like Kajabi. I haven't even thought about it. You know, honestly, all I've done is the outline for these courses. And I keep saying I'm making courses, but I haven't done anything on that. So I'm looking forward to just getting to work on those. And I spoke to my office manager recently. And what we're going to do is just carve out a couple hours during my work days during the week, because I just can't make it work otherwise. And it's really important to me to get these done. So I just have to prioritize it. So I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to, I know, I just want to say I'm looking forward to the holidays with the kids, because they're just, they make everything so magical. So that's one thing, obviously, I'm very much looking forward to. But in terms of work, just continuing to grow, continuing to help more people, educate, that's big. I am I'm a member of ICMO. I'm looking forward to becoming a fellow. So that means submitting some cases. So that's sort of what I've got on the books for this upcoming year. And it's exciting.
I love it. I love it. What does the fellowship afford you, or what's the process with that?
Yeah, the process is I have to submit 3 cases where I utilize neuromuscular dentistry to bring relief to patients. And so that's not going to be too difficult, because I use it every day all the time. And so it's just getting those cases documented and submitted the way that the protocol requires. I am attending some courses with my team at the beginning of the month of December. And so we're going to be coming up to your neck of the woods for those courses with Myotronics. And I'm excited to bring my team, because they've never been to the courses. So I'm going to be really heavily dependent on them to like help put together these cases that we'll be submitting. So once we've gone to that course, then I think we can really start to rock and roll and move forward with submitting the cases. So I'm really looking forward to that. It's going to be fun. And just to spend some time with them. Like, we were excited to go out to dinner together and talk and do stuff besides work. So that'll be fun.
That's amazing. Well, and once your team is on board, then they're the ones that are just like advocating and you know, telling the patient, you know, educating them as well. Exactly. And so
you've they'll got that. Run the show a bit too, which will be
they great. Make your job easier.
Yeah. I've got a good team and we all get along, so it's good.
I love it. I just really appreciate you being on the show with me. Like I said, I'm so excited about being able to talk to you. I love your educational videos. You've got a really great way of explaining things. I love everything that you're doing. So keep doing it. And I hope we can like continue to keep in touch. And, you know, I think it's great to be able to talk about cases together and share information. Yes, I love that.
I love it too. Yeah. Well, thank you so much for having me on. This was so much fun.
Yeah. Oh, it was fantastic. Well, I hope you have a wonderful holiday season. And thank you for being on Draw Talk.
Of course.
Thank you for joining us on this amazing journey through the world of TMJ disorders with our fabulous guest, Dr. Priya Mistry. We've explored the depths of TMJ disorders from comprehensive treatment to the interconnectedness of oral health and overall well-being. To keep up with the latest in TMJ care and learn more from Dr. Mistry, don't forget to follow her on Instagram, YouTube, and TikTok. For more discussions like this, subscribe to our podcast, Jaw Talk. I'm Dr. Tiffany, reminding you to stay humble, stay curious, and happy holidays. We'll see you in 2024.